up, guys? Welcome to my house. I literally just finished my beautiful garage, and I thought I'd let you in on all the cool stuff I did. All about garage finishes, or maybe sheds. Today's Build Show is sponsored by Northern Tool. Let's get going. Man, I love power washing. My champion generators, my champion power washers, super awesome. But don't forget, guys, winter's coming. Make sure you put your pump antifreeze in. If you don't drain these and use an antifreeze in there, you can actually crack the pump. Very expensive repair. So Northern Tool sells this. You can buy it other places as well. It's gonna be a pump antifreeze for pressure washers. All right, so my garage. Here's a scoop. I lived literally across the street for 15 years. 70s house, drywall everywhere in the garage. And in fact, this garage, when I first bought this house, had a cabinet in place, and this was an unconditioned garage. When I took the cabinet off, it was disgusting mold everywhere. My last house, all the drywall was bad because all my taint joints were falling down. So in this house, I said, look, I'm gonna build this like a real man's garage. And I decided to have no sheetrock anywhere. Now, in reality though, I do have a little bit of sheetrock, it's hidden. Anytime you've got living space above a garage, you need to sheetrock it. So where you're seeing this beautiful hemlock from Delta Millworks, prior to that, we installed 5/8 Type 8 Type X sheetrock. We also fully insulated the garage walls and the ceiling, but in this space where the ceiling's kind of lowered right here, this has my boy's bedroom above. That has Type X drywall on there. And then by adding that wood ceiling, believe it or not, I'm giving my, if there was a fire in the garage, I'm giving a longer period of time before it would get to the room above. It would leave us time to get out of the house. But no sheetrock on the rest of the walls. Now I did zip system sheathing between my house and my garage on walls that were adjacent to living space. So where you see this beautiful plywood, underneath this here where my kitchen is and this over here for my living room, that had zip system sheathing originally on it. So it made the install of this plywood pretty straightforward. What you're looking at here is a 3/4 plywood. You can see it's kind of like an apple ply or what I would call a birch plywood, but it has a, hopefully you're noticing a little bit of a shine to it. This is what they call UV finished birch plywood. A lot of times it's used for cabinet interiors. Now this fluctuated a lot during the pandemic on price, but I actually bought this at a relatively reasonable price point. I'm hoping that plywood gets back there again. I paid about 80 bucks a sheet for this. And then I had my finish carpenters install it. And you're gonna notice that I actually had them install it with visible screws. I wanted to be able to access something, maybe take down a couple panels and run a new wire. So these are some SPAX screws. I went with a smaller head. This is a number 8 sized head. I had my carpenters make them flush, and I did them in a pattern where we struck a laser line as we were going. Obviously they're on studs, but I wanted everything to be nice and lined up. And I think the screw heads kind of go away when it's all said and done. You're also going to notice, because of my power washing, because it could be wet in the garage, I didn't run the plywood all the way down to the ground. I first ran some 5/4 by 8 Versatech. This is a PVC, a solid PVC material. When I say 5/4, what I mean is it's actually 1 inch thick, so you're gonna have about 1/4 inch of that exposed because this plywood here is 3/4 of an inch. And that I ran to the bottom and then dropped the plywood right down on top of that. That means that as I'm power washing in the corner over there or any of these other places, I'm not worried about water wicking up. I didn't paint it, I just left it all plain white. And I think it looks fantastic. So my garage, nice and durable. I can attach things anywhere. You know, I put a Ubiquiti camera in the corner and all I did was screw it right into the plywood. No drywall anchors necessary. I did a bunch of Alpha shelving. I'm a big fan of this. This works really well. And I did some Gladiator garage cabinets just because they were pretty straightforward and relatively inexpensive. And this is just tool storage and long-term storage for me. And then the workbench was a big deal for me. Now, a lot of what you're seeing here came from Northern Tool, with the exception of this Gladiator piece and this top. But this is a wall control system that I found online in their catalog. I don't know if you've bought from Northern Tool before, but for years I got their big thick catalog on my desk at my construction office, and we would order tools and ladders and all kinds of things. I didn't have a store near me. These days, of course, you can order it all from the web, and in fact, a bunch of these things I ordered from the web. I had a bunch of boxes delivered and it was really straightforward for me to put it together. Or you can go into the store. For instance, when I was trying to figure out which socket trays to do, what to do with all that, it was really easy for me just to pop into the store and check it out. And man, look how nice these are. This is a deep drawer, and they've got a socket tray for each one of the sizes. So let's see, this is my 3/8 drive sockets in metric, and they've got them in black and red, so you know which one's metric and imperial. And now if I'm doing a project, I can just drop that out, put it right on the desk, and I've got everything that I need right here. Isn't that cool? I really like that. And then for the wall control, if you haven't seen these before, this is a steel panel. So if you've got magnets, magnets will of course stick to it. You know, if you've got a tray that you wanna hang up, you're good to go. But they make these really cool little hangers for it. I need to figure out how to make them not fall out though. I have had a little bit of an issue with these being loose when I take something out. So some of my crescent wrenches, if I wouldn't have held that, you can see how it could have come out. I think I'm gonna have dropped a dab of hot glue on there just to make sure these don't come out. But they go in super easy, and then drop your tool right in there and you're good to go. I've also thought about doing some outlines for my tools. You know, those black outlines you see a lot of guys do. I'm honestly not the most organized guy in the world, so having an outline for that would be really good. Plus I have three boys, of which a couple of them are pretty good wrenching mechanics these days, and I want them to be able to put everything back. You know, I've got beautiful full sets of all my crescents wrenches right now. I want to make sure that all of my metrics get back to where they belong, all my imperials get back to where they belong, that sort of thing. Oh, by the way, this is kind of cool. I didn't get this from Northern Tool. Fireball Tool, I think I got this, but check this out. This is kind of neat. Thread checker, like what you see at the hardware store. You can check your bolt sizes on anything, so you could have some random bolt and figure out, okay, what's my nut size here? Oh, here we go. It's a quarter 20 thread on, oops, on that particular bolt. So that's kind of a fun little tool. But as I said earlier, everything else on the wall control came from Northern Tool, and they do such a good job. I have a couple of things I'm hoping to install fairly soon. I haven't gotten to it yet, but I got a new compressor and a new hose reel that I'll use specifically for airing up tires. Check this out. Here's another big benefit of insulating your garage. I use Rockwool bats everywhere, so I can actually set my garage to heat, cool, or dry mode with a Mitsubishi mini split. This is a 1-to-1 head. The outdoor compressor is right on the other side of the wall, so it's just a freon line that connects it. And I'll set that, you know, 7 or 8 degrees hotter than my house, let's say, in the summertime. So if my house T-stats at 72, I might set the garage at 80, but we regularly get 105 degree temperatures in Texas, which means my garage is really nice and tempered at 80 degrees. The reverse happens in the winter. I'll set this at maybe 60, 65 degrees. So I can easily come out and do a project at my workbench. Also, if I've got food storage out here or some prepper storage, that sort of thing, none of that stuff's gonna go bad. So that's been a really nice addition, having that Mitsubishi mini split head. And I would tell you too, you don't wanna run ducts from your house into your garage. A mini split head is definitely the way to go. Oh yeah, I did want to mention, when you look at this wall control in the Northern Tool catalog, man, they've got all kinds of options. I think I need to arrange this a little better, so obviously my drills aren't in front of my wrenches, but like, you know, a specific hammer holder for your boss hammer, specific shelves that you can use for all of your gloves or tape measures, that sort of thing. That's pretty awesome. But then I also found a bunch of other tool catalogs or hook catalogs. These are from Sugatsuni. These are some rubber coated hooks, and I use these in a bunch of my places in my house just to be able to hook up, you know, the dog's bag or our swim bag, that sort of thing. I did custom make one shelf. My metalworkers, Johnny and Mark, made this custom shelf for me because this corner, I really wanted a spot to hold my Yetis or my chairs, that sort of thing. So that's one customized shelf, but everything else pretty much straight out of the catalog, and Northern Tool is a great, great spot for that. That being said, that's pretty much the basics on the garage. Let me take you out to the shed, and I'm gonna show you another option if you didn't wanna do plywood or if this was a little too heavy duty for you. Okay, garage part two, my shed. I've always wanted a third car garage. I didn't have the room to do that here. So my shed, basically a third bay for my garage. Now we did something different here compared to the finished 3/4 birch UV I did in the garage. This is called Trusscore. I learned about this at the International Builder Show. My friend Lydia Drywall Shorty introduced it to me. And I gotta say, very intriguing product. What you're looking at here is 100% virgin PVC. The color is throughout, so there's no painting here. It comes this white or this gray color. You can get it in either color. And on the bottom here, this kind of wainscot, this is their wall panel. I could have used this everywhere, on walls and ceilings like I've got here, but I decided to use their slat wall product from the wainscot up. Now, these guys actually helped me do the design. I sent them the plans, and they did a material takeoff. They even gave me a really cool 3D color rendering of what the garage were gonna look like. But this is a really interesting product in that instead of drywall, which is really not a good choice for an unconditioned space like this shed or like your garage that's unconditioned, you know, drywall can tend to mold on you. It's not waterproof. You can't really power wash or hose out your garage. This, on the other hand, being PVC, no issues with any of that. We could power wash this whole shed or garage space. No big deal. There's no mold issues here. Also, no painting. You know, when it's done, it's done. And if I were to scratch this, the color is all the way through. So no easy way to touch up a scratch necessarily, but because that color is integrated, it makes it really easy. Now, we're on day two of install here. So pretty straightforward install, and Nathan and Mark have been doing a great job. And in fact, check it out. Nathan's putting a panel in right now on the wainscot. It kind of goes on like a siding, really. He slides that panel in, and you're gonna notice he's using a truss head screw. He's screwing it right to the studs. And here's what the bottom, let's steal one of these, Nathan, for me. Here's what one of the bottoms look like. You can see, I think this must be where the Trusscore name comes from. Pretty stiff. I mean, this is a pretty rigid product with those cell cores in there. And it's flat paneled in gray. I really like this gray color. And again, you can get this in white as well. And pretty similar to a siding project, they've got J-trims. You can see he's putting that J-trim up on the side. And there's a J-trim here around this door that it basically just slides right into. And these slat wall panels, Nathan, these come in eight, these are 8 footers, right?
I believe so. Okay,
so the slat walls are 8 and 10s. I'm pretty sure that's true. On the other hand, the wall panels, these flat panels, you can get those in a variety of sizes. I checked the website, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, and even 20-foot panels if you want on these wall panels. So that's pretty nice. And then where these two abut, you see we've got a U-piece here, and then there's a trim that's going to pop right on there to cover that up. Now on the slat wall, they've got a bunch of accessory hooks that I'm going to be using to kind of organize the space. And these worked pretty well. I like this. They've got a kind of a C shape on the top here that pops in, and then you jam it in, and you've got a bunch of different options, including some shelves. Now I'm on bare studs here. I have a sense that maybe these would be a little stiffer if this was on drywall or maybe plywood. These aren't quite as strong as what I'd like to see, unfortunately. But I wonder if they would be stronger if we were on drywall. One caveat too, these are intended to be bike hooks. They're listed as bike hooks on their website, but my little dad cruiser here from State Bikes, I had a hard time figuring out how this would work. It's not quite long enough. I mean, I guess I could do this kind of maneuver, but I don't know. I don't love the bike hook idea. I need to figure out an alternative bike hold situation. Let's talk cost here. Now in my garage, you saw I used that 3/4 UV finished birch. It's just finished on one side. Today's dollars running about $80 a sheet. So it's actually come down a little bit from its highs not too long ago. So that runs about, I don't know, $250 or so a square foot. This wall panel on the other hand, about $350 a square foot. So a little bit more expensive. I think the savings you're gonna end up finding is labor though. I mean, it took Patrick and Dan, two of my really top-notch finished carpenters, several days, if not a week, to do my whole garage in that 3/4 plywood and really make it look pretty and show those screw heads. This, on the other hand, we're on day two of the install, and once we're done, we're gonna walk away. As I said earlier, no painting, no caulking, no finishing, totally finished. The slat wall is pricier. This runs somewhere between $6 and $8 a square foot for the slat wall. Now they, as I said earlier, they did the layout for me, which is really nice, so we could kind of figure out how to do this garage. I think you could do this though in laundry rooms. Maybe if you had an old 70s garage that had
a really bad looking drywall job where your paint was looking bad, your tape was coming out, you could go right on top of this. I think that would be a great solution for this product. Overall though, I think it's gonna make a really nice garage and totally different than the look that I was going for in my main garage. One other thing I wanted to mention, you can see my roof is sloped here because I've got a shed roof design, no pun intended. So we're gonna have to figure out how to rip that end panel and do some things that are a little trickier. If this was just a standard square space, I think we'd knock this out a little bit faster than we would have without a couple of those difficulties here. Anyways, let's get back to the garage.
Okay, y'all, you saw my garage, you saw my shed. I'm really happy with the way this turned out. One thing I forgot to mention when it comes to future-proofing that I did that I think is worth mentioning, I put two high-powered plugs in over here. This one is actually a plug for my RV, and I just have it converting so I can power some power tools over here. But this is a 30 amp 120 plug, which is what my RV, I have a Lance camper, and when I pull it in the driveway, I plug it in here. The next plug over though is a 50 amp 220 plug on a separate breaker. That's ultimately what we run a welder off whenever my guys have been doing some work on the side of my house, but that's my future car charger plug. And I wonder if I should have actually done a bigger breaker than a 220-50, but certainly that will give me what I need in the future and I could do a charger here. I have a Chevy Silverado Electric on pre-order. We'll see what it was only like $100 deposit. I know some of you have done that over the years with the Cybertruck or whatever. So I'm curious what the final price will be, whether that'll work. For $100 it made sense, but that's my future car charger. I definitely could see an electric car in the mix at some point.
Hey friends, we had a really cold snap last night, and I thought before we closed out this video, I'd give you a little evidence that the insulation is actually working in my garage. So last night here in Austin, Texas, the low was 15 degrees. While I'm shooting this video right now, it's 28 degrees. It's about lunchtime here. And check this out. My thermostat on the wall is reading 64 degrees in the garage here. And the heat is set to come on at 62. So we had no heat on from my mini split head last night. That being said, let's throw the FLIR on and I'm gonna switch to video from the FLIR. Let's have a quick look at my garage with the infrared camera so we can see where we're having some heat loss. This exterior door, even though it's insulated, we're losing some BTUs around the perimeter of the door. It's air sealed pretty well, but there's no thermal break here. And my guess is that's where we're seeing some loss on that door. Walls look great though. All that rock wool insulation in the walls doing a real nice job. You can see the studs over here just a little bit. And you can see that I don't have any heat coming on out of that mini split head. It's the same temperature as the walls around it. You can see the studs just barely, but there's not much surface temperature. And this garage door, man, this garage door is doing a great job. That's an R17 door from Overhead Door Company. I'll have to look up the specs and put a link in here for you on the exact door model. Double pane insulated glass. The garage slab is uninsulated. We're losing some there. And I suspect there might be a little bit of an air leak in this corner. And that's why we're seeing a darker spot that appears to be in the 40s right there. But even the side jam weather stripping is doing a pretty decent job right here. And then this first part of the wall, until you get to the ceiling there, that's an exterior wall. You can see the studs, it's cold out there. Ceiling is insulated so well you can't see anything because I've got rooftop insulation up there as well, plus rock wool bats in the bays. And then this wall here that has cabinets and this wall, houses on the other side, and the ceiling here, houses above. So those won't have any leakage at all.
Anyways, guys, thanks for joining me. Hopefully you learned something on this. Hopefully my garage inspired you to do something cool with your garage. This is honestly a dream come true for me. And the money that I spent out here, way more than just a standard garage, but man, I'm gonna enjoy this for many, many years, possibly maybe decades to come as well. Big thanks to Northern Tool for sponsoring today's video. They're a really cool catalog. I've used them for the last gosh, probably two or more decades, long before I was ordering anything on the internet. I was using their paper catalog. There's some great people to work with, and they've got a lot of options out there. You saw some of their tools that I used on today's video, but I'll put a link to Northern Tool in the description below. If you're not currently a subscriber, hit that subscribe button. You know, we've got new content here every Tuesday and every Friday. Follow me on TikTok or Instagram. Otherwise, we'll see you next time on the Build Show.